their 4,000 years of history had never waged an aggressive war, been forced to fight. To fight and die by the millions. China was to be the giant back on which Japan would ride to world conquest. Japan was a united, well-knit, highly regimented military dictatorship. Their aim, the absorption of China and the fulfillment of the Tanaka Memorial.
In Moscow, the leadership of the Soviet Union kept in touch with developments to the south of far eastern Russia. As a bulwark against further Japanese expansion, Stalin made sure that his border with Japanese Manchuria was well defended. It was a wise precaution. In July 1938, a border dispute at Lake Kasan led to hostilities between Imperial Japan and the Soviet Union. It was no small skirmish. Artillery, tanks, and support aircraft were deployed by both sides. But it was the Soviets who emerged victorious. The following year, tension between the two nations resulted in another border conflict at the Outer Mongolian River of Khalkhin Gol. Again, the result was a victory for Stalin, in what proved to be a substantial engagement, lasting from May until August 1939. No fewer than 50,000 Japanese were listed as casualties. In the days that followed, Soviet commanders negotiated a truce with their Japanese counterparts. But regional tension remained, and it was an uneasy peace that now endured along the Manchurian-Soviet border. And the intentions of the Japanese remained a concern amongst the leadership of the Soviet Union, a leadership that was dominated by Joseph Stalin. In the course of human history, there have been few political leaders as ruthless as Joseph Stalin. A Georgian peasant by birth, Stalin became leader of the Soviet Union in 1924 and remained in power until his death in 1953. Stalin's power was absolute within his borders, as his national cult of personality confirmed. To Stalin, terror and violence were legitimate political tools. In the 1930s, millions of Soviet citizens paid the ultimate price as their leader unleashed bloody purges of anyone suspected of opposition to his rule. Many of the Soviet Union's finest military men were amongst those who perished. Stalin's ruthlessness applied equally in foreign affairs. In 1939, he stunned the world by authorizing the notorious non-aggression pact with Hitler's Germany. This act of political expediency went against everything Stalin believed in, but it achieved the result that he wanted. When the Nazis unleashed the Blitzkrieg in 1939 and 1940, the Soviet Union stayed on the sidelines, giving Stalin valuable time to prepare for any conflict that lay ahead. The Soviet leader also made a similar deal in the East. By early 1941, Stalin was increasingly concerned by the potential threat from Imperial Japan. So in April that year, the Soviet leader authorized another non-aggression pact, this time with the dominant power of the East. The Soviet Union was now formally at peace with both Japan and Nazi Germany, and Stalin was succeeding in keeping his country out of the Second World War. But it would not be for long. On June the 22nd, 1941, the greatest land invasion in history was unleashed by Hitler against the Soviet Union. The start of Operation Barbarossa meant the end of the 1939 non-aggression pact, as the Wehrmacht swept across Soviet territory in three huge army groups. It was the beginning of one of the bloodiest conflicts in human history. And it was this epic war that secured Stalin's place in history as a great military leader. Stalin allowed nothing to distract him from his objective of defeating Hitler. And there can be no doubt that the Soviet leader proved an inspiration to his people as they eventually turned back the German advance. Cleverly, he played down the importance of communist ideology as his people began to win epic victories at Stalingrad, Kursk, and other great battles. This was the Great Patriotic War, and Stalin's appeal to nationalist sentiment played a huge part in his eventual triumph. At Tehran in November 1943, Roosevelt and Churchill tried to persuade him to open a second front against Japan in the east, but Stalin refused to consider the idea. Only when Germany was on the point of defeat, in April 1945, did he agree to strike against the east. As Soviet troops entered Berlin, Stalin ordered preparations to begin for an attack against Manchuria. Soon, the Soviet leader would pit himself against his counterparts in Japan. For many people today, the figure most associated with Japanese Second World War leadership is General Hideki Tojo, who became his country's prime minister in October 1941. A powerful advocate of Japanese military expansionism, it was Tojo who authorized the attack on Pearl Harbor, and it was Tojo who became the only wartime premier to be executed by the Allies when hostilities ended. But Tojo was no longer in charge when the Soviet Union began preparations for the attack on Manchuria in 1945. In June the previous year, following Japanese defeat at the Battle of the Marianas, he was forced to resign in favor of Lieutenant General Kumiaki Koizo, a weak leader who himself did not survive in power for long. In April 1945, Koizo was replaced by Kantaro Suzuki, a 77-year-old admiral whose military experience stretched back to the 19th century. He had fought in the war between Japan and Russia in 1904 and 5, and he had succeeded in remaining close to the center of power as the Second World War unfolded. But even as prime minister, Suzuki did not enjoy anything like the power of the leader of the Soviet Union. He was certainly not his nation's head of state. That title belonged to the hereditary emperor, Hirohito, the ultimate Japanese leader. Hirohito had the status of a god amongst his people, and he was theoretically above the business of day-to-day politics. But we know that the emperor took a great interest in the progress of the war. The extent to which he influenced policy remains a matter of debate today, but there can be no doubt that as a symbol of Japan, the Divine Emperor was a powerful inspiration for his armed forces. The loyalty of the Japanese soldier to the Emperor bordered on the fanatical. Death in battle was a joyous expression of that loyalty, and the imperial cult contributed much to the sheer ferocity with which the Japanese went about the business of war. It is significant that the Soviet Union remained fearful of this fighting spirit.
The favorite exercise is bending their backs each morning to Hirohito's holy palace. It develops the spine. In the classroom, there is absolutely no instruction in international relations nor economics. Yet the men who are graduated help rule Japan. Their lack of knowledge about other countries, about the qualities of other people, about production, causes them to take wild gambles. But on other subjects, they are very thorough. Trigonometry, chemistry, history. There is a great emphasis on languages. German, as an Axis partner. English, they once hoped to use it in California. And Russian. A favorite cultural pastime is kendo. Being pounded on the head is supposed to make a man alert. There are other outdoor studies, signal practice, surveying. And this class in yelling, to prepare a man for giving commands and to try scaring the hell out of the enemy. Eventually, every Japanese officer candidate must specialize. Many go into cavalry school. Others go into the armored forces. The engineers, whose instructors have spent years rigging bridges in China. A popular course at Japan's West Point is the artillery. most glamorous